Okay.
So, my name is Yuri Panchul. So, I'm actually not application engineer and not like full-time trainer. I'm actually R&D engineer working in MIPS i6400 processor core. So, and I'm a little bit involved into MIPS MicroActive UP core as well, because I was doing some verification environment for external customers who integrate our core in their SoC. And because I know external interface of this core very well, I actually was involved in technical part of creating the MIPS FPGA earlier. And I'm going to give you some ideas of what we are going to do with MIPS FPGA later this year, and how you can use it in a more interesting fashion than what is described in a getting started guide. So, but first of all, let me check if I need to give some additional details. So, does everybody in the room know very log and basic RTL to GDSI flow? So everybody pretty much knows. So I don't need to go into hardware basics. Okay, good. So basically, when this first version of the package was introduced, the immediate complaint of several professors was that you show us how to put core and how to connect it with 7-segment indicator, but so what? This is essentially doing Arduino, but the processor is on FPGA board, rather than on Arduino. So there is nothing interesting in it. Basically, MIPS FPGA allow you to do more. And we created some additions to MIPS FPGA, which I will show at the end of the day, which will go to the version we plan to produce at the end of summer. But actually, you can do this right now, because experimental version of it is already available on GitHub. So you can just download additions, get base MIPS FPGA package, and use it. And I will describe what it is. But first, let's go through the main question: why do you need to use MIPS FPGA at all? Because there are many other cores on the market. Xilinx has MicroBlaze, Altera has Neos 2, ARM has ARM Design Star, there is OpenRISC, there is Berkeley RISC 5. So what is special about MIPS FPGA? So what is special is that MIPS FPGA is at the same time core in source code, and at the same time it's industrial core, which has a lot of licenses. So this code base, it started some long time ago with course MIPS 4K, 4KE, 4KC, M4K, which was heart of microchip PIC32MX, then MIPS 14K, 14KC, MIPS MicroActive UP, there are also new cores created just last year, which is essentially MIPS MicroActive UP plus virtualization and security. So virtualization for security and floating point. But if you don't worry about virtualization, this is pretty much the same core, the same code, this is exactly the same code people in companies like Samsung are using. And during the life of this code base, it was licensed definitely more than 100 companies. So MIPS M14KC itself, which is predecessor of MIPS MicroActive UP and is almost the same code, during the first half a year on the market got like 20 or 30 licenses alone. So, and those licenses used in things like small chips for like near field shopping, like a device you like use in store to shop, like using near field, like many different applications. So, if you look to any alternatives, the advantage is very clear. If you get ARM design start, with ARM design start, ARM gives you obfuscated core. So that you cannot see its source code, you cannot connect wires to like internal registers to observe behavior of caches, of system of processor, of TLB MMU. You cannot add instructions. So next, like ARM design start also does not have caches and MMU, which is important part of education. So if you compare to Altera Neos 2, Altera Neos 2 is Altera FPGA specific. And if you want to make ASIC out of it, you have to go to Synopsys and license for big bucks ASIC version of this code. Now, with Xilinx Microblaze, you have similar problem as with Neos 2 because this is FPGA specific. So, but with MIPS FPGA, students or researchers can build prototype of system on FPGA, and then they can, like if they want to commercialize this project, then they can find investors for some startup, show them the prototype, get money, buy commercial license, and make ASIC out. So this is possible in principle. If your student have a VLSI course with like a timing closure, with like place of ground, inserting like scan chains, they can also use MIPS FPGA as example of industrial code. So this is something you cannot do with Neos 2, design stack, with microblaze. Now there is also Berkeley RISC-V, which like Berkeley people put as a next like mainstream technology in education. The problem with RISC-V, there are three problems. One, it's less supported by the current textbooks. Second, it is not sufficiently different from MIPS to get some like extra value. So it's pretty much very similar to MIPS, just like everything is free. But they don't have industrial users at the moment. They don't have chips made, and even when they do, which will probably happen in the next like couple of years, you cannot substitute core with a few licenses against core, which has like a lot of licenses. So same thing with Spark based Leon 3, Leon 4. So with MIPS FPGA, you have a very clear advantage, and the ideal use from our perspective is first student use generic textbooks like a computer architecture by like Patterson, Hennessy, or they use like Harris and build some toy processors. And once they get idea about pipelining and forwarding, they use commercial core, which is MIPS FPGA, and then compare what they did as a toy design against how it is done right now in the industry. Plus, they can do a lot of interesting experiments. They can add instructions using user-defined instruction mechanisms, and they can get build tools which get algorithm and like expressed in C and like split it into pieces that can be put into hardware, and then create like simple interface between hardware and software, and analyze performance benefits if you put some parts of design in software and some part of design in hardware. So you can put the verification class like around it. So you can build system where you verify on unit level some like units in the core like cache, or verify bus, or verify core itself against the model like QMU. So put some code that compares the result of instructions in core and in QMU, and like this kind of features. So for you educators, this benefit, like as I explained, is like very well defined. So it's not something like matter of degree. Like it's just very clear. For those alternatives, and for us, it is good to build some network of participants who can contribute some like research papers, some additions to MIPS FPGA, and maybe some like really interesting designs. Like University of Singapore, they created non-coherent mesh with like 64 processors, like little MIPS FPGA cores, where they added instructions to send messages to their neighbors, like send and receive, like using mechanism which I described at the end of the day. And now they can experiment with like parallelisms, with putting like algorithms into parallel hardware of this sort. Yeah, so this is a general preview. And once, so we will go through some like basic standard labs, and such will go through like our main sequence. So then the colleagues from Regent will tell you some more, and then we'll go through labs like I put for MIPS FPGA Plus, which is a non-released experimental version of something you will see later in the year. Okay, so we got done with such a
okay.
Thanks,
Yuri. Okay, so let's go ahead, make open the boards, and let's start.